We have an overabundance of smart people today to sort of talk about this field and help us think about what a freedom to innovate looks like, what different threats to a freedom to innovate might be. And as an opening speaker after Joey and me, we have my old friend Jonathan Zittrain, who is literally the best person I can think about to have us think about different constraints to innovation. Jonathan's book, The Future of the Internet and How to Stop It, is the best thought through examination of the way in which technological, legal, and normative barriers might keep us from inventing the future. And so I'm absolutely thrilled that Jonathan was willing to spend some time thinking about what are the different ways that we're constraining freedoms to innovate. And what's really excited me about this was I started getting texts from Jonathan last night essentially saying, what if I went over 30 minutes? What if I went to 35 minutes? What if I had more to say than I could possibly fit in? So the reason you see me grabbing my laptop is I am about to sit down and blog this talk because I am very excited to hear what Jonathan Zittrain has to say. And with no further ado and taking no more seconds away from him, I now invite him to the stage. Jonathan Zittrain, co-founder of the Berkman Center for Internet and Society, professor in 19 different departments at Harvard, including the law school. Wonderful guy. Take it away, Jonathan.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Ethan. I wish I could have like an advanced look at your blogging of my talk, and then I would know what to say. It would make it much better. But thank you very much. Excellent. Is this too loud? Loud enough? Just right? Excellent. All right, so let's hit the hackers where it helps. I wanted to try to open with a set of musings around getting beyond the trenches, because so much of what we're going to talk about today rightly has to do with making sure that the kinds of adventures we go on results at best only in a prize from the Austrian emperor. You didn't say what the prize was, Joey. I still worry that the prize was a ticker tape parade and then an execution. But anyway, mixed bag is what we call that. But I want to talk about getting beyond the trenches and, with a little bit of a historical perspective, give my sense of where this effort of freedom to innovate and to make sure there is breathing room to do it, where it has begun and where it's going. And what better place to make such musings than MIT and the Media Lab, a place that has been really at the forefront of this kind of stuff. So when I think of the spirit, the ethos, as Joey called it, of freedom to innovate, it might be historically a scene like this, which is to say a bunch of nerds having disassembled their PCs. What they're doing with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 monitors is not clear to me, but the kind of thing that says, we're gonna just plop it on the floor, we're not caring what time it is at night, and see what we can build. Now, of course, they've already got that substrate, both of hardware that's amenable to being disassembled and reassembled that way, and something like this magical thing, and I grew up a TI-99 person, but had to come to, at one point, pay obeisance to MS-DOS. You get that blinking cursor, sky's the limit. You can even rewrite MS-DOS in MS-DOS, which makes it, in my words, generative, in Corey's words, the general purpose computer and general purpose computing. These are the tools that we inherited in order to kind of do the kind of tinkering we wanted to do. And those tools included hardware tinkering. So you get a bay system in your tower, and it means that anything that fits the tower and speaks PCMCIA or some other form of interface can do it. This is the PC Easy Bake Oven. So in your own PC tower, you could make your own corn cakes Have people got any ideas? No? Fire codes? That's what you're thinking about, isn't it? Anywho. Yes, reuse is a viable alternative to recycling. So yes, just put it near the heat sink. Anyway. What then are we talking about with freedom to innovate? To put it out of images and maybe into words, it might be being able to create new things, not everybody tell you ahead of time what those things are going to be, or to be able to adapt existing things, to tinker around the edges. There's already something cool, but then you can lift the hood. poke around a little bit and optimize it or change it in a way that you wouldn't maybe have had the energy or time to make something entirely from scratch. So I think that's worth a category completely unto itself. That has its own history. This just goes back as far as, say, 1978. You can probably tell by the hairdo. This is a Heathkit, where they would just give you a sack of chips and a circuit board and very careful instructions such that you didn't need to have any theory of electrical engineering at all to just follow the instructions, kind of like a easy bake oven. You would just solder, but then you'd be like, look, Ma, I made this. And in 1978, that would be occasion to say, you're gonna make a good electrical engineer for Sperry Rand someday, rather than maybe we should call the police. So that's the kind of history of tinkering. And then this kind of guy, probably not this kind of guy because he's really just the model. I don't think anybody who ever looked like that ever did this. But there were people like, you know, I don't know, maybe like a young me, that would then go to a place like this, which is a kind of ham fest, right? Ham radio fest, where people would get together and show off to one another all of the cool equipment they had modified, wired together in interesting ways, and talk about stuff. And I think this is an important kind of piece of the puzzle, because it says it's not just about creating and adapting in your own fortress of solitude. Occasionally, you would emerge and through very careful dotted line paths go to a place that other people from fortresses of solitude would end up, and you'd have a community of some kind. And part of freedom to innovate then to me is being able to join and contribute to a particular community for which then those innovations may make it out to the world at large. But there's really something cool about being able to meet people who are interested in the same particular subset of things that you are and to learn from them in the apprenticeship model, because so much of the learning that takes place to get the skills to innovate in technical communities, it's through apprenticeship. It's through having other people show you what they did rather than just through reading the manual, following the instructions, and hoping that your solder doesn't trip too much. I then bring us around to around 1998, and here we see Stephen King's first venture into the world of online publishing and digital rights management. He found in his desk drawer a story so bad that even Stephen King couldn't bring himself to publish it, despite his voluminous oeuvre. And Riding the Bullet was put inside the Amazon Glass Book Reader, which was kind of the PC's first attempt at something resembling a Kindle in 1998. You'd have to hope to have a color screen. And one of the great features was if you clicked next page, it would go to simulate the sound of a page turning, to assure you that this was a genuine book by Stephen King. It, in fact, I think was priced at zero. It was an experiment, so they didn't charge anything. They didn't even have the payment systems fully worked out to do it. Folks at MIT hacked it anyway, just for fun, to see if they could, and it turned out that they could. And this was the leading drop on the crest of the wave of conflict between those who were safely tinkering in their own RF bands with ham radio and the rest of the world, and in particular, the world of commerce. So the sequel to that drip of water of the coming wave is the compact disc, right? Here's the appropriately titled Get Right With The Man. And this disc, it turns out, was meant to just be played in CD players, but it turns out that that modular PC had a CD-ROM drive reusing the compact disc format to be able to store stuff by burning it. But it also meant, obviously, you could read it by ripping it. And then you'd get things like, people remember Audio Grabber? How many Audio Grabber former, the statute of limitations is over, so you can tell us now. That few, huh? Boy, we gotta stick together. So Audio Grabber was some piece of software, God knows where it even came from, and you could rip your CDs, and it would even show you if it had ripped too quickly with the used CPU time, don't overclock it. There was inexplicably a grasping hand in the dialog box. I don't know why. It was the days of cool software that you didn't know where it came from. And then you could rip your CDs. And this was like, this was going to be war with the music industry for understandable reasons, and many of the people here are veterans of those conflicts. But this is an example to me then where, for the quote real world, they were saying, this tinkering has gone too far, And it's too easy to take Audio Grabber and get it beyond the community of people who'd rather build their clock rather than buy one. Something needs to be done. And it may mean, as that battle was joined, that for many people, freedom to innovate had this form of liberation quality to it. That as a substantive matter, music shouldn't be locked up this way, and it ought to be shareable and modifiable and such. And that's kind of where you start getting into the free culture wars and what that means. It might also think of liberate as innovate to freedom rather than freedom to innovate. If you come up with a way to lock something up, we're going to come up with a way to unlock it because freedom. And that was an argument implicitly persuasive to some and utterly anathema to others. And you see the industry responding with ventures like the Secure Digital Music Initiative. If it had a tagline, which I'm not sure it does, it would be to make the PC safe for the CD. To make the PC, when it's playing a CD, just like a CD player and the other appliances that we know and love. And they hoped to have industry adopt it voluntarily, the standards of the SDMI. If they didn't adopt it voluntarily, maybe the law should be brought to bear. And there is historical example for that. In 1992, so we are surely pre-internet for all but a handful, basically at MIT. In 1992, Sony came up with the digital audio tape player. Here is its model from the late 80s. And it could have a standard thing that looked like a cassette tape, the medium on which music was shared, but it would be digital. And because it would be digital, any copy of a tape made tape to tape to share with your friends would be the same fidelity as the original. That scared the music industry, because why go buy a CD if that tape you get from a friend is as good as the original CD? Now, because this is just one manufacturer and there's no PC encasement to it, this is an innovation, to be sure, but not the result of tinkering, Sony could negotiate with the industry, the music industry, and come up in 1992 with a compromise, namely the Audio Home Recording Act, which would say that no person shall import, manufacture, or distribute any digital audio recording device that does not conform to the serial copy management system. And this would say that if you make a copy with a DAT, and you now being Sony making the DAT, not the poor schmuck that bought it, if you make that copy, you must ensure that a copy cannot be made of the copy. No grandchildren, only children. And it's funny I should say children, because you might wonder, surely there is a spec more specific than what I just said. And there might be, but it is nowhere defined in federal law. Federal law just says it and capitalizes it. And in a set of definitions that is as capacious as this, that we're only into the C's on this text, and it in fact does define children as that person's immediate offspring, whether legitimate or not, Title 17 does not define the serial copy management system because it wasn't done yet. We actually didn't know what it was, but the parties negotiating this deal knew what it was going to be, and that was enough to enshrine in law a deal among our betters about what the right balance would be in the world of digital audio tape. So this is all a bit of history to say there was reason the music industry thought they could do something like this again and just come to a concordat with the big players. And the way you also do it, of course, is anybody currently getting money flow can just try to divide up any revenues. So not only did the Audio Home Recording Act say you are not to build or import a device, a digital audio tape recorder that will make a copy of a copy, it also said you're going to put an extra tax on the device. You must charge more, and when you do, that extra money goes into a fund that goes to artists who are still presumably being hurt a little bit by the children of those digital audio tapes that are being copied. And how does that fund get divided? 66 2/3% are allocated to the recording funds, 2 5/8% are to the sound recording funds in an escrow account managed by an independent administrator. If you are already getting sleepy, that's the point. This is the kind of dividing up of the pie that was possible when there weren't people tinkering at the edges. You had a few big parties with opposing interests that could come to accord, including in dividing up the cash. Well, that starts to get shaken by Audio Grabber, And by things like this, the Rio MP3, long before Apple ventured into the space of MP3 players, how many people had a Rio? Anybody remember the Rio? Gosh, like Corey and Joey are like, yep, in fact, I'm listening to one right now. In fact, I think Corey is running Audio Grabber right now.
In a VM,
yes. Has to do it in a virtual machine now, but still, it's fun. So this thing gets sued by the industry, the music industry, saying that it violates the Audio Home Recording Act, even though the AHRA knew nothing about MP3 players at the time. Turns out they lose, but this is the effort to try to put back into the bottle. And at the time, it was not clear it was impossible. There were people saying it was impossible, like John Perry Barlow, but the industry had reason to think this could still work. This is an act from 2002, originally called the SSSCA, the Security Standards and Something Certification Act, later led to the Communications Broadband and Telecommunications Promotion Act, the CBDIPITA, that was meant to say that if you had a general purpose computing device, it's got to have something like the child of the SCMS on it, so that bits that didn't want to be moved, that request would be respected. There was, in 2002, not that long ago, a thought that you could do that. Didn't pass, not really that easily implementable, and as a result, you end up just with other methods tried by the industry. They say, all right, you want freedom to tinker? Tinker to freedom. We want freedom to tinker to block your freedom. So this is the day, October 31st of 2005. We're almost on the 10th anniversary when a guy named Mark discovers that there's some weird stuff on his system. And today, if there's weird stuff on your system, that's exactly not weird. It would be weird if there weren't weird stuff on your system because viruses are everywhere. But he's like, what is a rootkit doing on my system? I know about rootkits, and I didn't put it there myself. And it turns out to be he had put a CD from Sony music into his drive to listen to. And it turns out when it's auto-execute, it had delivered a rootkit to the machine for the purpose of keeping an eye on everything he was listening to and making sure that he wasn't ripping disk. So it lived there forevermore to make sure it wasn't ripping a disk. He was very upset. The entire world was like, Sony, how dare you do this? It turns out that when an individual innovates to rip, that doesn't raise as much public ruckus as when a company innovates to spy. And here are the top three Sony CDs that had this quality to it. The Invisible Invasion, Suspicious Activity, my favorite, Healthy and Paranoid Times. So maybe the folks at Sony Music had a sense of irony as they went about what they did. But this also then raises maybe another spoke to our hubbed wheel on what is freedom to innovate. It may well be some form of audit function, the ability to have a computer into which you can peer and say something's not right. And maybe only 1 out of 1,000 can look at a list of processes running on the machine and say something's not right, but that person can then blog it, and before you know it, there's a class action suit against Sony for having, I don't know, they had 3 causes of action because they always do, fraud upon the consumer, maybe violation of some of the acts that are not very well regarded in our circles because of their effect on innovation. Bizarrely enough, Sony is now in the shoes of the innovator for the purposes of locking stuff up. And so Sony was like, okay, we won't do that anymore. But when you're talking about auditing, this becomes an important plank of freedom to innovate, to examine, as Richard Stallman would say, to learn from the code. And back to the SDMI, these are the days that some here will remember when Ed Felton and his team had taken something called the SDMI Challenge, much less tasty than the Pepsi Challenge. The SDMI Challenge was, SDMI is not just a set of rules they were proposing, but actual standards that would lock music up so that, like the serial copy management system, copies wouldn't be copied unless they should be. And there was a challenge to say, can you defeat the SDMI watermarks that we're putting in? And Ed Felton was like, yes, we can. And there was a prize, actually, $10,000 to the team that could do this. But it wasn't just like, now tell us how you did it, take your $10,000, and we shall never speak of this again. That was the subtext of the text of the context. Ed was like, wait a minute, I'm a professor, I'm going to publish this. And he started getting letters from the music industry saying, if you publish this, we're going to come after you for breaking a comparatively new law from 1998 that tries to proscribe hacking. And by hacking, let me define this very narrowly, I mean figuring out, developing tools to, and then applying them to break systems that protect works covered by copyright in America. And it might be that the act of breaking it before this law is not breaking the law. The minute you use the fact that you've unlocked the door to go in and copy the work, maybe then you are infringing copyright. But before you do that, you've done nothing wrong until DMCA 1201 comes along and says, no, the act of breaking it is alone a felony and something you could be sued over in civil court. So either the government can come after you or a private party injured can come after you. That's the essence of 1201, and it's what they were threatening hitting Ed with, because Ed hadn't infringed anybody's copyright, but he had shown, was ready to show, how to break a system that was designed to protect it. Now, people like Kit and Andy and Jack can tell you more about how all this is going to work. I guess these days Kendra could probably weigh in on it as well. So talk to them if you're interested in breaking systems to protect copyright, and they will take you aside for attorney-client privilege and then tell you what to do. But in the meantime, this was one of those battles that showed how law was responding, even if it wasn't prepared to do the kinds of technology mandates that the Audio Home Recording Act had represented. I should say, by the way, this is one of my favorite exceptions to 1201. So remember, 1201 says you can't hack. There's the librarian's exception. Says, well, understanding that there might be reasons to hack that even involve ultimately making a copy, but aren't themselves an infringement of copyright. Like, for instance, anything that would be a fair use. 1201 says even if you're hacking for fair use, you're in trouble, at least on the first read of it. Here's one of the exceptions for librarians. If you're a nonprofit library, archives, or educational institution, and you gain access to a work solely in order to make a good faith determination of whether to acquire a copy of it, then it's okay that you did it. But you may not retain the copy longer than necessary to make such a good faith determination. Okay, so you can hack this like CD-ROM of weird stuff that you don't know what it is, so you hack it, breaking in the first instance 1201, and you're like, oh, it's the Canterbury Tales. I don't want it. Oh, quick, destroy it. We know we don't want it. We must destroy it now. That's what we're talking about. I guess it would have to be a copyrighted instance of the Canterbury Tales, but those can be found as well. So this is crazy, right? This is like, I remember one day Hal Abelson showing the agricultural and horticultural exception.
That's my favorite.
That is Hal's favorite. And if we have extra time that Ethan's given us, we'll just have to display the horticultural fair exception to the playing of music aloud while you enjoy a meal, which... Excellent. We may have to do that just to show how elaborate and baroque copyright law has become. But let me assure you, this is an example of an exception in copyright law that I guarantee you has never, ever, ever been invoked and further never will. This is placative language meant to say, librarians. Oh, there's an exception for librarians. They've been taken care of. I got to say, like, I was going to say I don't mean to brag, but this is not really bragging rights. I run a library. And I guess we could have a model of the White House in the library. Anyway, I run a library, and yet the idea that it's like, all right, team, like, Jack, I want you to hack this work because I don't know whether or not to acquire it. I just please bask for a moment in the utter incoherence of something that members of Congress sat down solemnly and wrote and the president signed. It's just a very strange thing. By the way, if you make any tools to help us do that, you go to jail. So you have to roll your own tools to figure out how to hack. Very strange. Okay, so the larger point though is, why should this zone have to be one of cat and mouse? The industry releases something with some form of protection or boundary, and then they just have to hope that
the folks in this room don't hack it and release the hack to everybody in the world. Or people in this room figure out a way to unravel something and then wonder if they're going to get sued over it. Will they get prosecuted over it? It's just strange that we're drawing the line on what will be the state of affairs by just whoever is more fleet in deploying the technology one way or the other, or deploying legal threat one way or the other, independent of who is right substantively on the legal outcome. There ought to be a way to have it that if I want my fair use, I don't have to hack to get it. And the best you're ever going to get with 1201, with litigating it, with pushing against it is, okay, you can try to hack this thing for fair use. You can try to get into Facebook and get the data you want to research, and maybe they won't be able to sue you because you're doing it for good reasons. Now, good luck. Try to beat the wall around Facebook. That's a weird cat and mouse game. Why shouldn't the cat and mouse, I guess it's really the cat and gerbil? That's a mouse. Anyway, why shouldn't the cat and mouse be able to make peace and actually figure out, you know what, Facebook? This is the data you need to release to your own users or to others wanting to do research properly anonymized and not de-anonymizable, so that we can understand what's going on in the world that Facebook is such a huge part of. Why shouldn't that be part of the understanding rather than I've got it, good luck trying to get it, and if you get it, good luck trying not to get sued or countermeasured over it? That's a kind of aspirational plea to sort this stuff out rather than just fighting for the right to take a crack at hacking something for what you'd figured to be good purposes. In the meantime, the beat goes on, and Ed Felton again found out, for instance, with voting machines, that hotel minibar keys could open the locked compartment that protects the guts of the machine. They didn't try to stop him from publishing that, but another group of, I guess we could call them hackers, managed to hit the Diebold server and extract a bunch of emails that included Diebold employees saying that these machines are terrible. They don't count votes. I wouldn't count them to tally anything. And Diebold responded with another part of the Digital Millennium Copyright Act, not 1201, but something called 215, that said, you've got to take this stuff down, website hosting leaked emails, because those emails are creative, copyrightable works by their Diebold employee authors working for hire to make these lyrical emails that we might put in a handsome bound leather volume someday and sell as the Diebold letters about broken voting machines. And therefore, this premature leak of them needs to be taken down and demand sent. And you have like kids at Swarthmore hosting the Diebold emails on a Swarthmore server, Swarthmore getting hit with one of these takedown notices, and ultimately a pushback under a little used part of this section of the DMCA saying, this is a bogus takedown. You should have to pay Diebold for having abused the takedown provision to take down something that is not, in fact, a great literary work. And Wendy Seltzer, who's, I think, going to be here later today if she's not here right now, was one of the, oh, there's Wendy, one of the lawyers. You should tell the 512F story in all of its glorious detail, because that's a great example of a win on the side of allowing information to flow. But this, to me, is just a great example of it all comes together, right? Copyright tussles over auditing and integrity of devices, the right to tinker, to figure it out. In this case, it's meta-tinkering, because it's tinkering with the server that contains the emails that describes that the devices are not as good as we think they are. All of it comes together and relates, and I think that persists to this day. Who are these white men in coats and ties testifying for Congress? Well, given that it's that, it could be anything. And I'm being too homogeneous here. That guy is wearing a bow tie. But of course, these are executives from Volkswagen explaining why the car is a smart car, all right. It's like, oh, you're testing me, are you? Well then, no emissions for you. And these are the kinds of things that we think about in contemporary times when we look for a right to tinker, a right for access. And again, I want to put forward the question, it's not just, can I get into my own Volkswagen and make sense of what's going on in the increasingly inscrutable CPU without getting sued under something like the DMCA? That's one question. Of course, as most of the code goes cloud, it's going to be Computer Fraud and Abuse Act and other claims for those who will want to investigate. But again, why are we doing cat and mouse here? Are you kidding me? You need to be able to be opening up these things for people to have a look at. And if you don't trust government authorities to do it, because they've got their own structural complex incentives that may hold them up a little bit at getting to the bottom of something, you need to bring in the kind of people who like to build clocks rather than buy them to back it up. And looking for ways to do that seems to me to be very important. But those folks may be a little bit under siege. So here's our Heathkit guy again. Trust me, when you finish a Heathkit clock, as I did once, the last thing you want to do is put it into a burnished case, and then it just looks like a clock. The point of the clock is to show the circuit board. But showing the circuit board these days can lead to trouble. As has already been mentioned, Ahmed Mohammed found out. And figuring out in a society that is extremely security paranoid, is it healthy in paranoid times or paranoid in healthy times? I'm not sure which. But you've got people who are paranoid about what a circuit board might mean, and you've got people paranoid even independent of what physical effect that could have. Is that attached to a bomb? Are going to be worried about, wait a minute, you've tinkered with that circuit board, and that circuit board is now in my Volkswagen? I'm not sure I want to drive that Volkswagen anymore. I'm not sure that you did improve it. And in fact, I can come up with instances, right? This is a CT scanner, which has, frighteningly, Windows 2000 running its basic functions. How would I feel if, like, just some person had root access to the PC running the CT scanner for like 20 minutes before I used it? I don't know. Maybe this should be, like, if there were ever a place for the Secure Digital Music Initiative and to make it even more secure, maybe it should be for CT scanners. Was that a boo or a yay? Oh yeah, Corey's like, no DRM ever must have CT scanner processes available for all to edit while you are in it. I love the pleading in the alternative where Corey says, first of all, if you're going to have DRM, it needs to work. Second of all, it's never going to work. Third of all, if it does work, it has to be auditable, which means the CT scanner code should be up for all to see because there's no such thing as security through obscurity. Even though occasionally there is security through obscurity. If I hid my car key somewhere between here and my car and you can't find it, that is in fact security through obscurity, I've got to say. But we digress. There are issues, is all we're trying to say, that can be ventilated well as we move towards an Internet of Things so that the frontline things we're talking about are no longer payment for music, because message from 2015 back to 2005, we have more or less solved the music copying problem. The solution turns out to be Spotify. There are many reasons not to be happy with that, including the artists, but they were getting screwed either way. And the big powers that are fighting have moved on, but the place that they've moved on to is going to be security. And paranoid security reasons and not so paranoid security reasons, whether it's a CT scanner or your Philips Hue lighting system that turns out to have like first-order ridiculous bugs that make the argument Corey would make as to why it needs to be auditable so you can find the bugs in that thing. But there are bigger questions, again, that get cat and mousy here, which is as we get to an Internet of Things and everything is Internet-aware, should we make it like the original Internet where the whole point is once you are globally addressable with your own IP address, anything should be able to talk to anything. And it's up to the thing being talked to figure out whether it wants to listen. I.e. have a firewall. That's the baseline for the PC internet side of things. The things side of things does not come from that baseline. The things side of things comes from a baseline that says it's a light bulb that came from Philips. If it's going to talk to the internet, what it means is it's going to talk to the internet to Philips. And if you are far away and want to turn your lights off, so that you'll just know that the lights are darker in your home from wherever you are. You will talk to Philips, and Philips will talk to the light bulb, or Philips will prearrange for you and your light bulb to be able to talk without it looking on because it has so much locked down your discussions with your light bulb. That's a very different starting point, and we're going to have to figure out how to deal with the Internet of Things in a way that either they'll be coming from the baseline of things only talk to their vendors, or they'll be coming from the baseline of, no, this is really just the internet with things. Things can talk to each other, and if there are security problems, we'll solve them somehow. These are not the same position, and trying to reconcile them, especially against a backdrop of legal liability, when things go wrong, when things turn feral, you want to be able maybe to turn to the vendor and say, this Philips light bulb burned down my house. You've got to answer for it, Philips. If Philips is like, hey, we just sold you the Raspberry Pi bulb. Somebody else programmed it to be an easy bake bulb but left it in the lamp. Who's responsible for that? These questions are completely unanswered in 2015. Even in theory, they are unanswered. And in the meantime, you have folks like Amazon yesterday proudly announcing their new Amazon Web Services Internet of Things platform. I love the committee that sat together to figure out what will our iconic things be. Car, washing machine, iPhone. I wonder if they got trademark permission. Pen, glasses, and that's right, crane. We need something big. The Internet of Cranes. So all these things want to talk to each other. The crane has an urgent message for the washing machine. I'm working overtime today. Get ready for more soap. I don't know what. But all of those things will go through Amazon, through the four-tiered process of S3, DynamoDB, Kinesis, and Lambda. Which of these things is not like the other? All of them. And this registry is going to somehow be the way that things can talk to other things with security, because the crane won't be allowed to talk to the washing machine unless Amazon is satisfied that each is secure. This is the emerging attempt at a framework filling a genuine need that we don't even realize we have yet. And what does Amazon get out of it, aside from controlling all of the communications among everything? Well, here's the opening prices, depending on your region, per million messages, little pings going back between things. And for those of you who think about net neutrality and the idea of charging per bit or something, guess what? We're charging per bit now as long as they're the things talking, because Amazon is purporting to add value, and maybe they are. So the question again, the challenge to us from our individual silos is, how will things talk to each other digitally in ways that do assure some form of security, that don't assure some form of centralization, that once you've accomplished it, oh, did we say $5? We meant 10. Bits are getting heavier these days. Like, that's the kind of thing that really, to me, is the challenge that we have. And I go back to this blinking cursor, MS-DOS. Remember, for many, it's not MS-DOS. It's some form of GNU Linux or something. And we should give that tip of the hat to GNU Linux, because again, we're here at MIT, where so many iterations of Unix and later GNU Linux were born and forged. And MIT created the environment. Here's the environment called Mac, long before the Apple Mac. This was, I think it was multiple access computing. The idea of time sharing, that MIT could take a budget the way that Joey can casually pay for some lawyer at BU, and why shouldn't we anyway? We've got the money. This was Joey's predecessors saying, let's fill a room with computers and make it available to any researcher, not just at MIT, but anywhere, in a time sharing model. That made facts on the ground so that innovation could take place, and points to the crucial role of the university, along with the journey person coder, in the kinds of freedom to innovate we think we're here to talk about. Now, this is a particle accelerator at CERN, where other things also were born, other than new particles like the World Wide Web. And it took universities to have the wherewithal to do something that would be with like almost no commercial direct application, but still cool and worth doing, to get the money and the people together to make something useful happen. That's the Mac project, and that's particle accelerators. I do wonder if in 2015 we still have the university playing that role, because it turns out in order to do innovation today, in order to do research today on the internet, you're doing, say, the research on Facebook, and you're doing it because Facebook grants you permission and because Facebook does it. You're about to throw a chair. I thought I went till 10, do I not? Fair point. Okay. Well, in conclusion, no, I respect that, Ethan. Yes. That's very good. You're just tinkering with it for right now. In conclusion, the university has a huge role to play in bringing together, in defending, promoting, both individually and systemically, the spirit that we're talking about when we talk about freedom to tinker and freedom to innovate. And I worry that aside from a few pockets, one of which is where we are standing and sitting right now, this mission has been forgotten. And it's people like Peter Thiel helping that get forgotten, because like, the universities aren't doing anything useful. Get out of there. Just, you know, bring your PC with you and go to town. And entities like the EFF, who, when somebody gets threatened, are entities that can be turned to for help, and so that you don't feel, and your parents don't feel, that like they could lose their house over whatever you're doing in that room that seems to be making people so upset. This is not meant to indicate the role of universities and other big institutions as oracular. The whole point of tinkering, of auditing, of allowing without credential people to study and build and deploy is saying we don't believe that there's one oracle we should be listening to, and I could mean that literally in the IT industry, one oracle that's going to say how things should run, that we're better in a distributed environment where nearly anything can happen. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, and we do have about 7 minutes for a couple of questions. Lori Lejeune has a roving microphone. If you have questions on anything from how to obtain a PC-based Easy Bake Oven so that you can trick out your home system all the way through to the agricultural exemptions to DMCA 1201, yes. This would be the time to put them in front of Professor Zittrain. Hands up, please. And please introduce yourself when you're asking a question. Who is going to be brave enough to ask Jay-Z a question? Great, over here, please.
Hi, my name is Paola Villarreal. I'm working with the ACLU of Massachusetts as a Mozilla Open Web Fellow. You said that there were some security challenges with the Internet of Things. Do you see IPv6 as part of the solution?
No. The question was, there are security challenges with the Internet of Things. Is IP version 6 part of the solution? And IP version 6 is the successor to IP version 4. Don't ask about 5. IP version 4 was the thing that assigned a unique number, ideally, to every point of presence on the Internet. We're running out of those numbers. IPv6, in the first instance, is meant to make sure we've got more than we could ever shake a digital stick at, and it is delivery on that promise. There was some thought that as long as we're just assigning numbers to shit, why don't we assign a little more information, like a unique identifier for the object? So even if the object signs on with a different form of access, Ethernet versus wireless, still its identity comes through. There were some objections, including, I think, from EFF quarters. It was like, wait a minute, there could be problems with that, having to do with anonymity. Well, maybe IPv6 could be a vehicle for geographic zoning, so that at least you would know this is an Italian computer, and therefore Italian law should apply to these bits. Under the Treaty of Westphalia, that sounds like a great idea, even though it didn't directly anticipate that, having been forged in the 17th century. For many other reasons, it's thought of as not a great idea. So IP version 6, to the extent that it relieved the number crunch, is good, seeing it as a way of distinguishing more clearly in an innate way tied to a piece of hardware what is what. Very skeptical of that. I think we lose a lot more than we gain with that level of security. There should be identification of stuff, but it should be credentialed rather than tied to an innate object.
Great, please introduce yourself.
Joe Uchel from Passcode. there's nothing in the universe I want to know more about than the agricultural exemption, the DMCA 1201.
That wasn't really a question, but...
all right, let me see if I can pull this off.
Wait, was that setting up another question, or was
you just wanted to know the agricultural exemption? I really want to know that, and just imagine, like, my voice trailed off at the end of the
sentence. No. It was, I could get the sense that you were very, very excited. I'm now excited about this bowl of kanji, but... yeah, no, it's Lord only knows what happens next in this. Let me just take a moment to welcome everybody who's come in. Grab some coffee, grab something, come sit at the table. Whether you have a badge or not, we would love to have you here. The more the merrier. But we've got two more great talks coming up after we hear about the agricultural exemption. And we'd love to have you here and in your seats.
Okay, so... this is section 110 of Title 17, talking about some limitations on the rights that creators of music might enjoy against having it played without their permission or without compensation in public spaces. So if we were to play Eye of the Tiger right now, somebody somewhere should be getting a check. MIT is licensed up, but plays a blanket fee. Let me see if I can get... Sub six, I think Andy told me. And here I am looking for Horty. Come on, I'm not mirroring my screen, so I'm, there we are, Horty. Right, so one of the exceptions is a performance of a non-dramatic musical work by a governmental body or a non-profit agricultural or horticultural organization in the course of an annual agricultural or horticultural fair or exhibition conducted by such body or organization. It extends to any liability for copyright infringement that might otherwise happen, but will not excuse any such person from liability for the performance. So if you've been hired to play and you're the band, you're in trouble, but the 4-H Club might not be. It does lead to the enduring question that I can tell from Ethan is going to have to be my last word, and the profound philosophical question that I will leave you with is, if it is the first year you are doing the fair, how do you know if it's annual? Do you have to wait till year two when the fair happens to realize that it was okay to play?
And this is a question that we in fact have about freedom to innovate, and we will find out by the end of it whether we're going to do it again. We have one last quick question
that I understand
has nothing to do with agricultural exemptions.
So you talked a lot about the CFAA and copyright. How do patents factor into stifling innovation, especially with patents regarding the research exemption and its pretty much how that's been completely defanged? Is there a way to fix that, or is it pretty much unfixable at this point?
The only good thing to say about the patent situation right now is that it has become such a thicket, and creatures of industry now have realized it is as much something they could be attacked with as something they could benefit by, that even like the Microsofts of the world a while ago realized, and really changed their tune, say, from the early aughts, to say software patents in particular, and business method patents, one-click shopping, the idea of clicking on something once to get it, for which a patent was granted, that these are actually a problem. And now that you've got some big entities thinking it, oddly enough, those who are fighting patent reform often say, it's the little tinkerer who's going to be exploited, unless that tinkerer can hold Microsoft up for billions of dollars for some obscure thing that that person got. So the players around the table have been scrambled in a useful way. The courts, I think, feel a little bit more licensed that the Republic won't fall down if they turn out to take stuff that intuitively looks to them to be not even patentable under the current definitions, and they don't allow it. So I actually think of it as a little less of a problem than it used to be, because there are some allies in powerful places now seeing just how kind of out of sync the system's gotten.
Folks, let's get another round of applause for Jonathan Zittrain.